is like, this is cool. So let's implement it. A faculty member comes to you. You know, everybody's using, is creating MOOCs, so why don't we have a MOOC at Hostos, right? What is the reason? Why do you want to have a MOOC? And then you have that conversation. Or the tendency of, remember when, whenever we had iPads, everybody wanted to have iPads. And I remember we have a technology fee grant at Hostos where we use these funds to bring new technologies and to innovate. And that particular year, when iPads was just went wild, we had about, from 12 departments, we had about 6 or 7 departments that wanted to have iPads. And then whenever, when we had the conversation of why do you want to have iPads, like, because those are cool and every other university is doing it, so that we should have iPads. So that's why I mentioned that it's very important to be able to have that conversation, to understand what is the real problem that you want to solve. What is happening in the classroom that you're not able to answer with the current methodology that you're using. And then let's see whether a technology makes sense. Let's see whether an iPad makes sense. Maybe yes, maybe not. And then why don't you try it? Do it in a pilot way. And then if it works, now let's identify how we can improve it. But then having a different conversation, focusing on that pedagogical side.
Buenos días tengan todos. Mi participación en este panel va a ser en español. Entiendo que hay transmisión, ¿verdad? Sí. Respecto al diseño instruccional, quiero identificar primero que es importante identificar a cuál va a ser nuestra audiencia. ¿Hacia quién va dirigido ese diseño instruccional? Tengo que también identificar cuáles son las tecnologías que yo tengo disponibles. Una de las cosas que tratamos de hacer en nuestra institución es identificar lo que tenemos y qué recursos open source tenemos disponibles para no afectar las finanzas de la institución, incurriendo en gastos adicionales para el diseño de los cursos. Importante también que el contenido que se presente integrando lo que son las inteligencias múltiples, pero es difícil integrarlas todas, pues nos vamos con el método VAC, que es diseñar esos contenidos desde el punto de vista visual, auditivo y kinestético. Y así estamos atendiendo a una audiencia sin tener que dividir diferenciadas, sin hacer las actividades diferenciadas, le estoy presentando el contenido desde los diferentes puntos de vista para ese estudiante. Es importante también el diseño instruccional que no nos olvidemos de lo que es la motivación. Un estudiante que no se siente motivado hacia la meta, hacia la tarea, no va a realizar la tarea o va a realizar la tarea por cumplir con una puntuación. Si yo logro cada semana en estos cursos a distancia tener una introducción al tema donde el estudiante pueda ver que ese contenido es pertinente para lo que él va a hacer en el futuro, que va a ser un profesional en esa área, él se va a sentir más motivado hacia sus metas. Así que eso no lo podemos olvidar y esto va atado a la retención.
Well, okay, let me do a translation, if possible. Okay. In terms of instructional design, it's important to take into consideration various variables. One of the variables that you have was being aware of student needs. And you have to be incredibly sensitive to student needs to be able to design for that. That includes also needs in terms of software, use of open source, etc. But another element to take into consideration is student motivation. And to design for student motivation, which is key. And they had the VAC, the VAC system, which would be taken into consideration the visual aspect, the audio aspect, and the kinesthetic aspect of student learning. Is that a good summary? What is that? Let's go now toward, any questions on that? And yeah, okay.
Aware of and keep into consideration. Do you think the quality matters standard for online insurance? Do you think that meets what you are saying we need to be aware of as we create these online environments?
Sí. Sí las apoyamos y sí utilizamos dentro de nuestra plataforma, tenemos la forma de diseñar rúbricas integradas, donde entonces estamos trabajando con cada tarea. Adicional a eso, cuando hemos trabajado los diseños, hemos considerado los estándares, ¿verdad?, nacionales de las diferentes organizaciones para el diseño de los cursos.
So yes, quality matters is used, but also take into consideration the different standards for course design also.
One of the things that is important to take into consideration is your culture, your institution. Sometimes an instrument could be perceived as being complex, and adoption could be a problem. Quality matters is great. It's rather long, rather complex for you to be able to follow it continuously. So one of the things that happened to us is how we can use the essence of these instruments. And I think we use another one from University of California, Chico, which is one of the ones that are being adapted from many other universities. So how can we take those elements and create an element that will be useful for our reality, for our culture, and simplify it, being that you are able to know your people, you are able to know your faculty, and how they could well respond to adopting a standard, as long as you create one standard that addresses national standards, but you're able to present it in a familiar way, same thing as instructional design for a class, in a familiar way so that your faculty are able to adopt it. That is key.
Okay, that's the first round that we had concerning instructional design from their perspective. The second one is, let's get into assessment, which is key here. And each one has a particular experience in terms of assessment. Carla, let's start off with you again.
Okay, now with assessment, and it may answer your question more fully. The MOOC on instructional design took a stance on authentic evaluation as a matter of assessing a more real assessment of the students' learning than what many MOOC platforms provide, which is multiple choice quizzes that just test recall knowledge. So in our MOOC, although the platform that we use, MediaX, which is the Ibero-American platform for MOOCs, even though that platform required us to have these multiple choice tests, it also provided the option of peer-to-peer assessment. And we leveraged that peer-to-peer assessment to create scenarios that were wide enough or generic enough that people could adapt them to their own learning needs and produce a deliverable that was then submitted for the assessment of their peers. Each student in the MOOC had to evaluate, I believe, three contributions from their peers in order for them to receive a passing score on their own evaluation. So their submission was evaluated by their peers, which counted for a percentage of their grade, but also their own evaluation of their peers' work also counted for the completion of that assessment. And that's how we got around to the assessment, a more realistic assessment of student learning.
In a MOOC environment.
In a MOOC environment, right, correct. Because the other forms like essays or more collaborative projects are really limited in the realm of MOOCs.
In our experience for approaching assessment, we've been focusing on a number of areas. One is the development process. How can we assess the quality? And then that's why creating those minimum standards are important to be there. We've, the development process for us in creating online courses goes using a mentoring model. So we have a faculty member that is experienced teaching online, who is going to be working with the developer throughout a year. While they develop the course, while they teach for the first semester. So we have kind of that guidance and that assessment that goes more loose assessment, because it's going to be a partnership between the mentor and the mentee. But they make sure that they're using the elements, they make sure that they're addressing the needs from the students, and they're also picking from the experience from the mentors who are teaching online courses as well. So that is from the faculty perspective. And then, everybody's familiar with a classroom observation, so there's a faculty member who has to be observed. We had the challenge on changing those instruments to be able to adapt to the different modality. It's not the same observing a class face-to-face than observing a class in a hybrid modality or an asynchronous modality. So we had to create those instruments so that whenever this observation happens, we define how the observation has to happen in the online world. So that is also another piece that was considered to be able to help in the assessment process. And then the last piece is the student perceptions about, well, the course is presented, we know that we can identify performance indicators, grades, but we wanted to hear from students, what is the perception of how the faculty member is providing the instruction and how they're perceiving it. So that was, we presented yesterday the results of the a survey that we conducted to students. And one could help us in confirming whether the approach